there's a publication that really, expresses my founding principles in my life, and that's The Onion. And one of my favorite headlines from The Onion is, "Professor connects thing, comma, other thing." So this is exactly what this talk is about. We're gonna connect Roma and Jews because I'm part of this congregation and because I'm Romani and my husband is Jewish. But that's not the only reason. I'm not original. Many, many people have connected Roma and Jews before for any number of reasons. So we're just gonna be doing it today with kind of a focus on mothers for Mother's Day. My four-year-old is definitely distracting me right now in the same room. It's okay. But I have this beautiful, beautiful bracelet from him. Just a fair warning, we will be talking about not just completely happy things. So if anybody's not okay with that, let me know. Let's see if anybody's in the chat. Okay, cool. I hope it's not appropriate, since we're talking about Roma and Jews, on Mother's Day, to talk about the mothers and grandmothers that are no longer with us. And I think that's one thing that I think our cultures do have in common, that, you know, we have particular mourning rituals, and we do tend to, you know, have a lot of remembrance of the dead. So I know in Jewish culture, there's a yahrzeit candle. We definitely have a lot of candles happening to commemorate the departed. There's a funny story about my mom. Let me share my screen and just show you. Hopefully this will work. That's not her. Can you see that? Yes, no? Oh, nobody's saying anything. Rabbi, yeah, can you?
Yeah. Yes, yes, we can see it.
All right, so that is my mother, just so you. So the funny story is that it's not funny, it's sad. My grandfather recently died of COVID. So we were mourning, and, you know, we were lighting candles, and nobody was together, you know, everybody was apart. And, you know, my mom and I are not typical Roma. We don't really believe in a lot of the, you know, supernatural stuff that many Roma tend to believe in. But this thing happened, like, you know, a few days after my grandfather passed away. And it was, I forget honestly what it was. It was some spooky thing that happened in the apartment. You know, and I kind of half jokingly told my mom, I was like, yeah, this really weird thing happened last night. Like, do you think it could be grandpa? I'm going to stop sharing because it's really weird to be talking to a picture of my mother. hold on. Okay. And she said, well, that's ridiculous. You know, why would he doesn't even have your address. Why would he come all this way, you know, from the Czech Republic to America to visit you? And, like, I mean, this whole time we're kind of, you know, like, we're joking. And then she stops and she says, but were you burning a candle at night? with the point being that that's what you're supposed to do to kind of keep the souls of the departed happy. And you know, she was like three quarters joking at that point. So that was interesting. I think in a humanistic Jewish congregation, that's maybe something that'll resonate with people. We have a lot of traditions. You know, and they're cultural traditions. We don't necessarily, you know, take wholesale kind of what our ancestors believed literally, and we kind of believe it more symbolically. And I think that's the case for me and my mom, and, you know, maybe that's the case for some of you. We will leave food for the departed. I don't know if that's something any of you are familiar with. That's a practice you're free to borrow, cultural appropriation, much better than wearing gypsy Halloween costumes. So speaking of, let's just kind of see where everybody is. Basic question, where do the ancestors of Roma, of Romani people, come from? Who knows? You can put this one in the chat, or you can unmute yourself and, okay, we've got one answer. Any other? I'm not going to keep you in suspense. That's right. Thank you to Josh, whoever you are. You have the correct answer. So, yes, what is now India, roughly 1,000 years ago, our ancestors came from that part of the world. So here's where we're going to get a little interactive. First, we're going to learn to count to five in Hindi, just to bring the point home that yes, we are. I know I don't look it, but soon you're going to see some photos of people who do look like they came from South Asia. I'm half Romani, so that's why I apologize for the visage. So, but the language that we speak to this day is an Indic language. It's not like we can go have a chat with somebody speaking Hindi. It's not quite like that because it's been 1,000 years, but a lot of the words are the same. So do this with me. If you want to unmute yourself, great. If not, just, you know, make your mouths move. So in Hindi, we're going to count ek, do. By the way, Steve, I don't know what your excuse is. Steve Lee.
Steve.
Teen.
I'm teen.
Char.
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 Thank you. Banj.
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 Okay. And now we're going to do it in Romani. Yek.
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 Dui.
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 Trin.
Trin.
Star.
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 Banj.
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 So it's just, it's almost identical, right? It's a small example. And, you know, it's such a great party trick to do with South Asians because they're like, whoa, it's the same language. So there's that. So then there's the different names for Roma. What is the common, what is the common sort of name for Roma? I think everybody knows. It starts with a G. And if you want to be my friend, please do not use a lowercase g ever for any reason. That's the one thing that I really don't like, because it gives people the idea that we're like a lifestyle as opposed to an ethnic group, and it has all these sort of associations with it that we don't like. So just think, you know, how odd would it be if you saw the word Jewish or Jew with a lowercase j, right? And yet we see the word gypsy all the time referring to our people with a lowercase g. So just, you know, sit with that.
Petra, can you clarify, since it's something not a lot of people know, I've heard that some people, some Roma, do not want people to use the word gypsy at all. Is that correct?
That is correct. I'm one of them.
Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I mean, it's because, okay. So it's a misnomer. It comes from the idea that we came from Egypt, as we've just gone over. We came from India, not Egypt. And, you know, it has all these, it's like the word to gyp someone, right? Like just all these associations we don't like, a lot of just kind of misinformation that's around that. So a lot of us, especially activists, are like, no, let's just not use that word. Now, that said, there are plenty of Romani people, like the ones living in England and a lot of American Roma, who don't mind or even sometimes prefer the term gypsy. So it's not my place to say, you know, nobody should use it, but it's kind of like the word queer, or kind of in some ways it's compared to the N-word, where like that's something that you can use as an insider, not so polite, putting it mildly, if you're an outsider, right? So, you know, people tend to go with that, just kind of, or like the word autistic. Is it a person with autism or is it an autistic person? Ask the person, right? If they want to be called a person with autism, you're going to go with that. If they want to be called autistic, you're going to go with that. All right, got a couple questions. What about the use of the word gypsy to refer to? Oh, yeah. Okay, hi, Louise, Josh's wife. So funny enough, there was a kind of a hubbub about that 1 or 2 years ago. Carol Silverman, with my input, I guess we technically co-authored a piece on that. I was quoted in the New York Times because the Broadway people decided to actually change. They had this ceremony called, what was it called? Something with the gypsies, and they had a whole, the what, Matt? The robing, that's right, the robing ceremony. And they actually decided to change it, which was really sweet and really nice, and there was a lot of backlash against that. So, yeah, so it's a thing. Gypsy refers to you have gypsy cab, gypsy moth, and gypsy like a person in a choir in a musical. And there's a whole background behind it that I'm not going to get into. You know, I think it was a really nice gesture that they decided to change it for all the reasons that I said above. I'm not going to get offended by somebody, you know, saying the word gypsy or using it for that reason, because I just don't get offended that way. But and Barbara, oh, what did they change it to? You know what? I don't know. I forget. I know I was like in the middle of the debate to, do you know, Matt? What? Okay. And so where does Gypsy mean the origin? So the word Egyptian became Gypsian, and then it became Gypsy, and it's the same thing in Spanish. Gitanos is the word for Gypsies in Spanish, and that came from Gitanos. So it's just this idea that we came from Egypt. Long story, won't get into anyway. So, okay. So we've covered that. All right, so let's get into some of the fun stuff, like what do Roma have to do with Jews? So much. First of all, let's just get one thing straight. Pretty soon, all Roma are actually going to be Jews if things are going the way they're going, because there's a huge rising tide of Romani people all across the world, in the Americas, in Europe. I mean, that's generally where we are, either Europe or the Americas, with, you know, some other places too, who think that we are the lost tribe of Israel. Spoiler, we're not. But they really, really want to believe that we are, and they have this kind of like biblical evidence. They have, I think, like a couple of rabbis somewhere in Israel who are like, sure, you're one of us, you know, and they think they're going to all move to Israel and everything's going to be great. And, you know, some of them are just like really like they're kind of getting these pseudo-Jewish identities. It's wild. And, you know, they're the kind of people that you can't really have an argument with them, because they've just decided like it's the evidence, it's biblical, and it's here. And, you know, and I've taken a DNA test. And if a Romani person in Europe takes a DNA test, yeah, chances are there's going to be some Jewish DNA, because guess what? People intermix, and especially Roma and Jews. There has been intermixing, so we will get to that. So I've never taken a DNA test. If I did, I know there would be some Jewish in there, because I happen to know that, you know, I happen to know of at least one Jewish ancestor that I have on my Romani side. So there you go. What should I do? I have a bunch of links. That's not one of them. So maybe I will do this. I'll quickly play this just because it's kind of funny. And it has Hatikva in it. But it's one of like bunch of videos now that you can see on YouTube that tries to like prove and show that Roma are the lost tribe of Israel. Not to make fun of these people, but it's kind of funny. All right, let's see. Share screen. Where is the screen I need? Here it is. Share. Now, where is the... Here we go. Semitic Jewish Roma Gypsies are the lost tribes of Israel. Israeli citizenship next week. Okay. I hope you guys will support me. Just kidding. Okay. We have other. So that's so much for the kind of lost tribe theory. That did not happen. But what did happen is that we did live on the margins of society in Europe, both Roma and Jews, for many hundreds of years. You know, partly separately, but partly together. And so you have places where people really kind of took that to the next level. And I want to stop and kind of say, you know, often people are surprised because they think, oh, Jews are, you know, tend to be well off and very educated, and Roma tend to be poor and uneducated. So why would, you know, they do things together? But there are a lot of different kinds of Roma, and there are a lot of different kinds of Jews, especially historically, right? So there were a lot of really poor Jews historically. And there are a lot of Romani musicians who were actually kind of part of middle class, or whatever, what was the middle class back then, but like high society. You know, they might have been musicians at the courts, and so were the Jewish musicians. So they definitely have plenty of reasons to interact. And there's a couple of geographic examples of that. One is in parts of Romania, there's kind of, you know, these sort of remnants, obviously not a lot of remnants of Jewish populations. But there's groups of musicians where basically they're neither Romani nor Jewish nor sort of Romanian or whatever. It's kind of like this, just this mixed ethnicity of just musicians. I wish I knew more about them. I've never like studied this directly, but this is a thing. And in Slovakia, I know from, you know, various kind of testimonies of elderly Roma that back before World War II, you had Roma who knew Yiddish, and you had Jews who, you know, spoke some Romani. And again, you had a lot of musicians together, a lot of people interacting, you know, and to some extent, sometimes intermarrying or having economic activity together. When you listen, I hear people, you know, when I listen to kind of like klezmer music or Romani music, it doesn't sound alike to me. My husband's like, yes, it does. But I have a lot of people, like my husband, Matt, here, who says, yeah, it sounds a lot alike. But that's because, you know, obviously you also have just plain old European whatever music that sounds like other things. But there is definitely musical evidence of this intermixing. One funny thing that I've never been able to figure out, so we have these things ethnomusicologists call vocables. So if you're singing, you're like, lie, 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 you know, shy, nai, nai, whatever, if you're not singing words. And there's sometimes what we do in Romani, and in, you know, where I'm from, like the Slovak Romani tradition, we sing shalom alom, which isn't like anything else that we do. So I'm just going to show you an example of a bunch of people, some of whom I know personally. My cousin and her now husband are in this video, singing just like this shalom alom alom, which I really imagine that, you know, that comes from actual like shalom, like them also singing maybe Jewish songs, which we do. I'll show you an example of that too. So let's go to share screen. Where were we? All right, let us leave the lost tribe of Israel. Why can't I get rid of this now? Matt, help.
Yes.
It won't let me minimize this and go to my other...
Stop share.
What? Really? Ay, ay, ay. Okay.
And now what are you trying to do?
Well, I need to share the other stuff that's on there.
Yeah. Or you can go to new share.
New share? But I need to go to this.
Yeah, so click on it and then...
Yeah, I did that. Now I can't get out of it. See my problem?
Okay. Oh, but you... Wait. I thought you wanted to get it up.
No, I want to get up the other thing that's in the... I'm so sorry. Here, okay. So every time I share something else, it's going to do this?
Well, if it's in the same browser?
Yeah, it's in the same browser.
No, you should... If you have it full screened, you just need to unfull screen the browser by going to the browser and unfull screening it, and it'll still be shared by Zoom.
Okay. All right. Sorry. Technical difficulties. Here we go. I'm going to share this now. I have to go back to Zoom, share screen.
So leave it on...
Shalom, alo, shalom. Yek doi trin shal, elo malem. Sol bekechu, kage pesko peske. Ke ama, ima kerem. Rom kishalem, kechana vayoni. Ashete, shalom, alo, shalom. Aina nana, shalom, alo, shalom. Tzim tzipor, shalom, alo, shalom.
All right. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take a bunch of links and I'm going to put them in the chat so that all of these videos from now on, and probably more because I'm pretty sure we won't get to all of them, you can watch on your own time. What happened to my Zoom? Here we go. Yes, and I see... Oh. Okay, and there's a couple of questions. All right, so there's all your links. Oh, why did the Roma leave India? Short answer, nobody knows. There's various theories, and that would take a long time to go through them. But you're not going to get the answer ultimately because there's not enough evidence for any of those theories, really. So, but, you know, two of them are, they were musicians or just kind of itinerant, you know, what's it called? How do you say it in Meslenik? Itinerant craftsmen. And the other major theory is that they were actually warriors and they only really coalesce, like, outside of India or, you know, after that point. Who knows? All right. And then we have, in India, did the Roma live near the Benai Menashe, which are Jews from India? No idea. We don't really know anything specific about the lives of Roma in India. Musically, which they were not called Roma when when they were back there either, so we're pretty sure of that. Musically, there was interaction between the, this is evident in closed music. Yes, absolutely. Okay, so we did that. We did the Shalom Alom.
Petra, did you paste the links? We don't see them.
Oh, that's because I pasted them to Steve instead of pasting them to everybody.
Okay.
There you go.
Thank you.
That's all of them. Okay. So I want to do a little bit of, you know, just to keep introducing who we are, a little bit of a mental exercise. Think about the different relationships to ritual tradition that Jews have in the world. So Orthodox Jews, us guys in the humanistic congregation, right? Two very different kind of extremes in a way. Different kind of, you know, strata, like socioeconomic, different subcultures. And, you know, think about how you feel about your relationship to other Jewish subgroups. Are there some that you maybe respect more than others? Are there some that you physically resemble more than others, whether it's the way, you know, you look or the way you dress? Are there some groups of Jewish people that you have more in common with, or some groups that you have very little in common with? And also think about the very major geographic differences in terms of language, food, traditions, just, you know, the difference between Sephardic Jews and Ashkenazi Jews as one example, right? And also Indian Jews, right? I mean, they're, right? Like all kinds of different subgroups of Jews all around the world. And so when you really go inside yourself and think about all those differences, now you have a pretty good understanding of the diversity of Roma. But that doesn't come easily, I think, because, you know, what you get in the media is one very tiny sliver, right? You get the really the stereotypes, or you get, you know, the nomadic Roma. You get a lot of wagons, right? Let's see. Let me go through this question. Where's the largest population of Roma today in the U.S. and abroad? In the U.S., you have all the major kind of metropolitan areas, various subgroups in New York City, a big population in Los Angeles, in Chicago, in Texas, just, you know, different subgroups kind of congregating in different places. And in abroad, we definitely, Eastern Europe is your place for the vast majority of Roma, which brings me to my point, though, which is that the absolute vast majority of Roma live in Central and Eastern Europe. And of those, you basically don't have any nomadic Roma, and you haven't had any nomadic Roma for quite some time. The ones that you kind of see in the, you know, English language inflected popular culture are the ones who historically lived in Great Britain and to some extent France. Also, it happens, you know, to some extent in Germany. Those are not Roma, they're actually Sinti, you know, a related group also speaking Romani. And those are the ones that have traditionally been really into, you know, traveling and having their caravans and that kind of thing. But it's a very small minority of all the Roma in the world. So, yeah, so there you go. Okay, Matt wants you to know, in case this won't somehow become obvious in the course of this talk, that, yeah, for most Roma, it's not like this, you know, giant lifestyle thing, like you can't tell us because we live in a caravan or, you know, have a crystal ball or something like that.
We wear different
Or wear different clothes, even, although, you know, like some, like Romanian Roma is where they really cut, you know, where they wear different clothes. But it's because most of us just look different. We, you know, our people tend to have much darker skin than the surrounding population. So that's it, you know, dark skin, black hair. So that's why, you know, the main kind of human rights issue stems from, no matter how well you acculturate, in most of these countries, people can still tell that you are Romani, and there's, you know, all these various repercussions from that. So, all right, let's move forward a little bit. So, okay, I already talked about Romania, Slovakia. Yeah, so let's keep talking about what we have in common. So we definitely have diversity in common, right? We have, you know, this the same idea where we're a diaspora. We have a common history to some extent. We have a common language. For us, it's Romani. For Jews, it's Hebrew, Yiddish, Ladino. For us, it's like many different dialects of Romani, also Para-Romanese, which are in a way akin to Yiddish, where it's not, you're not really speaking grammatically, you know, in the sort of original language. It's more like, you know, it sounds like English with Romani words, the way that Yiddish kind of sounds like, you know, German with other words thrown in. So that's a similarity. Now, so I talked a little about a little bit about intermarriage. And again, it's more than you would think. And I'm not sure, I don't have any statistics. You know, I don't know if it's just that, like, I happen to know a lot of people who somehow are Roma married to Jews, or are half Jewish, half Roma, that kind of thing. Or if there's some particular reason that brings us together as sort of like outcasts. I don't know. I'd be speculating, so I'm not going to do that. But you're free to speculate all you want. Go ahead. Go wild. Now, definitely for Roma, historically, or, you know, certainly in the past, that I know in the past, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and even going before that, Jews have been some of our best allies. So you have, you know, somebody famous like George Soros. I played in his last wedding, actually. the Prague Jewish community over the years has made a whole bunch of statements in support of Roma, because, again, in a place like that, if we had a lot of Jews left in the Czech Republic, the neo-Nazis would be targeting them more, but sadly, we don't. And as the fact is, the neo-Nazis, you know, very much, most of the time, are targeting Roma. But the Jews of Prague, the small Jewish community, is not blind to that, right? So they have made statements, you know, against just kind of solidarity, because none of us like Nazis. So that's something we can definitely agree on. We have other, you know, I'm in this organization. We have a fairly well-known musician who's a Czech musician, but he's Jewish. He's in our organization. He actually plays with a Romani band. So it's things like this all the time. Right here in our wonderful Zoom, we have my partner in crime, Steve Lee, who is apparently making dinner for some people. So her camera's off. But, or, yeah, are you going to say hi?
I'm turning it on for 1 second to say hi, everybody.
Hi.
Hi.
So Steve is Jewish, and she has just, you know, she's one of my closest friends, and she has done so much for the Romani cause. You know, she's a scholar, but she's a very kind of activist scholar, and she's helped out a lot. So there you go. An example of Roma-Jewish partnership.
It goes way back. We've been partners for 10 years in all of our endeavors, and Petra has been an amazing mentor and motivator and colleague with everything. So I just wanted to throw that out there, lest Petra gets self-deprecating about how awesome she is.
Yeah, I've been a bad influence on her. Okay, so that leads me to this really wild, and Steve, I don't know if you know more about this band. I don't really know anything about them. I think they're based in Germany, and they're like ethnically mixed. That's all I know. And they have this wild video called Gay, Gypsy, and Jew. So we're going to play this. I'm going to play it sort of from the middle. Let's see. Let me make sure I have it up before I try to share this. so that we don't have quite as much. Here we go. Now we do the screen share. Share screen.
Hey, right now, it's time to come out and say it quite loud. I'm Gypsy Jewish and gay. Right now, it's time to come out and say it quite loud. I'm Gypsy Jewish and gay. Gypsy and Jew, this is a 1932. Gypsy and Jewish and gay. But what I hear what people say,
we can pray how we pray. We can love who we choose.
We can play Gypsy play. Hey, Gypsy Jews.
Being Gypsy or being gay, on my head and my collar every day. And my Jewish friend, he's got to pray. They say it's his destiny, but it ain't. Then on the street, meeting diversity, fuck this purity of my identity. Like in 95, F4 in Harlem, Jewish or Gypsy, gay, what's your problem? We need the wisdom, so stop the bullshit. Let us go, kid, we rock and roll it. Looking up to the sky, seeking true. Black or white football, heaven is blue. So she like pussies, I like it too. Let her choose the way she likes too. And let me breathe when I grab the mic. Gypsy, that please, then yeah, that's right.
Right now, it's time to come out and say it quite loud. I'm Gypsy Jewish and gay.
Okay, so you can see the rest of that on your own. And there's tons. I mean, that's a particularly colorful example of our cultures or cultural references coming together. But there's tons of them. Steve can attest. Lots of Jews playing Romani music, Roma playing Jewish music. I'm not going to play it because it's in your links, though. There's a very famous Balkan Romani brass band called the Boban Markovic Orchestra. And they play Hava Nagila, but so does like every other Romani band ever. I mean, a lot of the ones kind of playing traditional music, you're going to have Hava Nagila. Great story from our very own congregation. Rabbi Aviva, Rabbi Tema's wife, was doing a really cool kind of get-together on Nigunim. I think maybe some of you were there. And, you know, so she's telling us all about, like, how these are prayers, you know, this is liturgical music, and she's singing these beautiful melodies, and she sings this one where it has a first part that I don't remember, so I'm not going to sing it, and it has a second part, and it goes like this. Die, 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 da, 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 die, 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 da, 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 die, 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 da, 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 die, 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 die. Die, 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 da, 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 die, 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 da, 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 die, 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 da, 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 die, die, die. So I'm sitting there trying not to crack up because this exact melody is the second part, also the second part, of a totally, like, one of the most, you know, everybody knows this song where I'm from. If you're Romani, it's one of the first songs you learn as a kid. And the words for that part are like, I don't want you anymore, you jerk. You know, like, go away. It's all about go away. It's, jamore, jamore, jamore. Wait, no, it's, sarmeles genava, genava, obala, chingera, chingera, jamore, 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 nakamavtut, sarmeles genava, genava, obala, chingera, chingera, jamore, 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 nakamavtut. Right, so there you go.
Aviva is here, Petra. She's surrounded by a number of children.
That's who I was waving to. So it was that was such a cool moment because, you know, I think, I don't know, you must have seen me kind of smiling or laughing or I don't know. I eventually volunteered the information, but I can't eat while I'm talking to you guys. That's not going to work. Anyway, so there's a lot of kind of, you know, interactions like that. Do I want to skip this story? We have so much to get through, but no. I'm going to say it. It's a cool story that just happened yesterday. So like 3 days ago, maybe 4 days ago, a conductor from Miami University in Ohio, who is Jewish, he's Brazilian Jewish, his name is Ricardo Averbach, and he contacted me and he said, oh, we're doing this, you know, series of like diversity concerts, and we're doing some stuff on Roma, and I got your name from somebody, from my bandmate, actually. And we would like to, you know, do a short interview with you just for context, you know. And I'm like, great, somebody wants me to be the token gypsy. You know, that happens all the time. So I was like, okay, you know, send me more information. And then he sent me some stuff. They had, you know, they interviewed an indigenous composer. And I was like, oh, okay, that's really well done. Sure, you know, I'll do it. And then yesterday he calls me and he says, the craziest thing just happened. So part of what they're doing, part of this concert, is, of course, is online, is a video that somebody made of the Berlin Holocaust Memorial in 2005, and somebody singing, you know, the story there was that, you know, like many Holocaust memorials, there was no inclusion of Roma, and at the time there weren't any plans for the government to, you know, sort of acknowledge the Romani Holocaust at all. So I happened to be in Berlin, and, you know, and I did a thing where I just sang a bunch of songs, like it was a thing related to this, and this random person came, and I don't remember that part, but took some video and ended up incorporating this into this thing that they're using. And they realized it was me that they had randomly contacted. And all this time, for, you know, 16 years, the woman didn't know who it was. Like, the credits in the video just say, like, Roma and Sinti activist in Berlin. And she is, I mean, this is the part that's also cool. So she's Jewish, but she's also part Romani. So, again, it's just like, that's the thing. I remember her telling me at the time is that, you know, she's had Romani heritage, you know, and that was it, because I was, like, in the middle of this thing, and then she left, and that was that. So now we've reconnected, and you have this, you know, great, just one more example of Jews and Roma coming together around music. It's Mother's Day, so, you know, I don't want to do too much on the Holocaust. What do you need to know? You need to know that there are several countries in which 70 or 80 or 90% of the Roma living there, or in the case of Germany, Sinti, were killed in the Holocaust. What are the total numbers? Nobody knows. The more I find out about what we do and don't know, the less likely I am to give you an estimated number. And I also don't think it matters. I come from a country, the Czech Republic, where 90% of Roma were killed. And that includes, what is the connection between Roma and Sinti? Excellent question. Sinti don't like to be called Roma, but they're a subgroup of Gypsies or Romani people. They speak a dialect of the same language. And in fact, I'm part Sinti. My family is mixed, like Slovak Roma, Czech Roma, and Sinti. So I don't see what the big deal is. But yeah, they like to keep it separate. Long story. So in my family, this was, my mom was born after the war into a completely, almost non-existent family, because most of them died. And the people who raised her, for the most part, were her grandparents, and they survived. It's, you know, a whole long story that I can get into another time. But the grandfather who raised her was actually half Jewish, ethnically. I mean, culturally, he was like all Romani. But his biological father had been Jewish. And so to me, it's always like, well, you know, what does that even mean that Roma were not part of the Holocaust, right? Anyway, that's a whole political thing that I'm not going to get into, but, you know, just to note that whether it's the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance or Yad Vashem or the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, which is funded in part by my tax dollars, or the United Nations Holocaust Outreach Program, all of these institutions do not consider Romani victims to have been part of the Holocaust. So if they include us, it's kind of like out of the goodness of their hearts. It's not something that they feel that they're supposed to be doing, really. You know, and if they do it, we're supposed to be grateful. I did want
Petra,
to...
can you clarify something for me? I just, when I was reading up on this, this is like, you know, what you're telling me is like so disturbing. I remember when I first learned about it, when you first educated me on this, and I saw estimates, like, you know, we have like basic estimates about how many Jews died in the Holocaust. You know, we have a figure of 6 million. Is that accurate? Probably not completely, but at least we have a figure. But I saw figures from like 600,000 to 1.5 million. And that just seems like an astounding range. How is it that we can quantify it for the Jews and really not quantify it for the Roma?
Yeah, I mean, it's a very complicated question. I would say, I mean, we're not looking at anywhere near the range that you quoted, but I know where you're getting it from. And to be perfectly honest, where you get it from is, you know, so we had an estimate of, you know, let's say 200,000. And knowing that, like I said, in a place like where I come from, it was just, you know, it's almost complete extermination, which is pretty bad. And nobody listened, right? So, you know, some of these, and not just Romani activists, I mean, there were some allies who also were feeling that, you know, this is not good, that people are not listening and they're not including us. And so they said, well, you know, there's so much we don't know. We didn't have, you know, unlike Jewish communities, we didn't have our own written records of like who's part of our community, right? And the governments didn't have very good records. And a lot of the Roma who died in the Holocaust, most of them, it's sort of assumed, didn't die in camps. They sort of died out there and, like, you know, being shot in the woods, that kind of thing. And there weren't good records for that, right? So that's why we don't have a good estimate. And you have people arguing like, well, you know, we can use what we have, and we, you know, come to a number like, you know, 150,000, and then like whatever we don't have in that is like all the people that we can maybe extrapolate from, like, people saying they were missing relatives, you know, that kind of thing. There's every few years now, you know, there's some kind of discovery where like, oh, here's another camp that we didn't know about that had Roma in it, right? Or here's a mass grave. But, you know, these aren't like hundreds of thousands. These are, you know, maybe a dozen people or 50 people or something like that. So we don't know. You know, that's the bottom line. We're not going to know. And you know, you have to look at the impact on the communities, right? And so, like, my ancestors, somebody said, what are the cultural linguistic differences and similarities between Roma and Sinti? So, for example, Sinti, that dialect is very, very different from other Romani dialects. Not, like, totally not, you know, mutually unintelligible, but, like, it's pretty hard to have a conversation. But in my family, we had three dialects, which is Slovak Romani, Czech Romani, or Moravian Romani, and Sinti. And the Czech Romani dialect basically is extinct now because almost all the speakers were killed. And then the ones who survive are like, we're not even like, we're just going to try to like blend in, right? What percent of the world are Roma? We have, again, it's a really rough estimate, like maybe 15 million Roma, maybe 20, something like that. We've got something like 8 million in Europe. It's definitely the largest minority ethnic group in Europe. I'm getting notes from my husband here that I should emphasize that Roma were killed by ethnicity or part ethnicity rather than lifestyles. It's really important because I do usually include that, and I left that out. So yes, because a lot of these arguments against including the Roma in Holocaust commemoration are, oh, well, it wasn't the same thing. They weren't killed because of their race. Well, it's just not true. I mean, this is not a Holocaust history lesson. But yeah, you only had to be 1/8 Romani in order to be subject to being gassed. So that's, I think, all the information you need. Boston. Okay, yeah, great. I mean, it's always interesting to see that somebody was taught about Roma in the Holocaust. You know, I've done a lot of formal, but just a lot of informal research on this. You know, I teach college, or my colleagues, I think, again, Steve can probably speak to this too. You ask any, you know, group of college students, they're not very likely to know the first thing about Roma at all, you know, whether it's in the Holocaust or otherwise. But it's always good to see exceptions. That's always heartening. And I think, you know, things are changing a little bit by bit, definitely. So let's see. We are kind of running out of time, so I'm going to skip a bunch of stuff. I mean, you know, I was going to say more about, like, you know, Jewish and Roma together in the Holocaust, but come to my next talk on that. Let's get to the motherhood part of this, because I promised you that. So I have a couple of songs queued up that are, you know, Jewish songs in English or Yiddish about motherhood, but I wanted to hear from you guys, because I thought that would be much more interesting. If you have any songs that, you know, are part of Jewish culture that are about motherhood that you would like to share, we can maybe look up on YouTube.
The one in Yiddish that I'm most familiar with is a Yiddish imamu.
Right, yeah.
And I'm familiar with specifically Dudu Fischer's rendition of it. But okay. And it extols the virtues of a Jewish mother, you know, how she cares for her child. You know, not a song that, you know, reflects new modern sensibilities, but that is, I don't really like the song, but that's what the one that that is in my memory. Well, Dudu Fischer is great.
Let me play a different version of it then. It's in Yiddish, and it's got, like, I'm going to scroll down, and it has, you know, a translation right there. And it's, yeah, I also have the Barry Sisters. So in one of your links is the Barry Sisters.
Yeah, I know. I'm familiar. The Barry Sisters do it better than Dudu Fischer. I agree. Yeah.
Yeah, you really would like more Roma songs. We will definitely get to that. I'm going to do a whole medley just in a few minutes. But yeah, I mean, I love thinking about, you know, our kind of respective relationships to mothers, because it is, like, you know, normal pop songs, you don't have, I mean, I guess most cultures have a lot of folk songs about mothers. With Roma, it's like this hyper huge thing where it's like every other song has got something about a mom in it. And I don't know if it's like that. You know, I don't know enough about Jewish musical culture, sadly, to know that. It was fun to kind of, you know, compare and to you know, do that search for, like, Jewish songs about mothers. And I found a bunch of stuff. So let me just share this one. All right. Which my Yiddish mama? All right. This is by Yosele Rosenblatt. Share. I wish I were master at this. Matt says you know. In Wasser, in Feuer, wollt die gelaufen vor ihr Kind. Nicht tausend ihr Feuer, du es ist gewiss, die Grenze sind. All right, so this one's kind of sad, but you can go listen to it because it's in one of your links. Matt, would you like to share your joke?
It's your joke.
My joke? Matt?
I don't even remember it.
Oh, well, I don't remember it either. It's a joke about Italian mothers, Jewish mothers, and Romani mothers.
It was your and joke.
What's the joke?
That the Italian mother says, if you don't eat your food, if you don't eat everything on your plate, I'll kill you, and the Jewish mother says, if you don't eat everything on your plate, I'll kill myself. And the Romani mother says, I'll kill both of us.
Oh, okay. Okay. Did you hear that?
Yes, we got that.
All right. So now you have that. All right. Let's get to a whole bunch of songs about mothers that are Romani songs. I guess that's what you all came here for. Doesn't matter what I skipped, right? I skipped the Holocaust songs. Maybe we'll get to that. But again, next talk. So just like Romani Mothers 101, the word for mother is dai. It's kind of, you know, but so dai. Everybody say that, dai. And it's like edai, the mother. If you want to do a diminutive, often you hear daiori, which is like, it's like mamala. So it's exactly like that, right? It's like mama versus mamala. So we have daiori, which is nice. But in these songs, and so the vocative, right, if you're like calling to somebody, it's either like daye, like oh mother, or dalke in some dialects. Like, oh, I can just do that right now. No time like the present. Where's my pick? Here's my pick. I even have a pick. Let's see. Here's my guitar. You can't see me and the guitar, but whatever. That's fairly good, because I'm not good at guitar. I really tried to tune this puppy before I... Nabiri nam to kama no shero Tara tara Sako pene o hoi me som nas valo Zle tu dao ke miri Zle tu do kos noro Skiki de miro sheroro Zle tu dao ke miri Zle tu do kos noro So that's one where you have dalke in the vocative. But most of the time, it's just mamo. It's very easy to understand. So, and you say like mamo miri, which is my mother. And you have no idea how many Romani songs, like a really huge percentage of Romani songs, have this in them. Because moms, and to some extent dads, but mostly moms, are extremely important in Romani culture. Do I have an album? Okay, yes, Facing History, that is a very good idea. Very good idea. And by the way, since we're giving links, let me give you guys a link for your one-stop source for all Romani culture, www.romarchive, where Steve also was my partner in crime on the music section, .eu. It is a really cool thing that you should all see. So, Mamo Miri. The first song I sang as you guys were coming in, that of course has a reference. It's somebody going off to war. The next two verses, I wrote the words. It's a war protest, of course, because I'm a leftist, you know, bleeding heart liberal. But, you know, the first verse is like, I left my mother to, you know, have to go join the army. So of course the mother's, it's not his lover, it's his mother, right? Who is much more important than any lover. Oh, where can we see Romani or Sinti in print? Again, your one-stop resource. Rome Archive has a whole literature section, which you will love. I love it so much. There are a few things in the world that I love more than the literature section of Rome Archive. So there you go. And it'll give you like all the various Romani authors. Okay, so where was I? I have a list of songs, my little set list here. All right, I got the guitar, so let's do a fun one. So this is going to be, what did I do? This is like my life. My entire life is losing my pick. Here it is. It's behind the computer. Okay, so this is a fun song. This is actually a band that you may have heard of or seen, Vera Bila and Kale, and they kind of do like, you know, Romani pop, but it's influenced by, it's one of these kind of like pan-Romani styles because they're influenced by rumba gitana, which is, you know, descended from flamenco. And obviously originally like Czech and Slovak Roma were not playing flamenco. Yes, flamenco is gitano or, you know, Romani style at its base. But, you know, now that we can hear a lot of other people's music, starting in the 20th century, people started kind of mixing different Romani styles sometimes together. So, I'm not trying to imply in any way that what I'm about to play you has anything to do with flamenco. I'm just saying, like, that's one of the influences that have happened on this band. All right. Pasho panyo ri chai ori mani melai gen kama. Pasho panyo ri chai ori. Mamo, demand money. Mamo, demand money. Mamo, demand money. Pasio pañuri bechelo Fori trema ujarelas Pasio pañuri bechelo Fori trema ujarelas Yoi mamoi La 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 It's all about like, mom, please give me some water. But, you know, this is a whole sort of topic in songs, which is like, you are talking about your lover, but you are addressing this to your mother. Because there's no way you're going to want to be in a relationship if your mom doesn't approve, if your mom hasn't given you advice. I'm not saying like your mom or my mom specifically. I'm just saying like the generic mother in Romani culture. Somebody asked if I have an album. Just look up the band Via Romen. There was, in fact, if anybody wants a free CD, I have so many CDs that I'm never going to be able to sell. So just let me know. And when you see me, you're welcome to have one. All right. So we have that. What else do we have? I'm going to do more. Oh, okay. I'm going to do something with the accordion, but I'm just warning you, I can't actually play this song, so I'm going to mess it up. But just to shake things up a little bit. So this is another Yoi Mamo. It's another major topic in Romani songs, which is that people are hungry. We're kind of a historically hungry people, you know, which is interesting because, like, everybody always says we're thieves. And I'm always like, yeah, if we did that much thieving, then we probably wouldn't have so many songs about being hungry, right? So, yeah, just think of that next time somebody tells you about gypsy thieves. All right. Which obviously you can turn around and say, yeah, if you're always hungry, you're probably committing petty crimes. But it's not the same as what we get accused of, which is like, oh, you just like get all the money. You take everybody's money and you're very rich. And it's like, nah, not really. All right, let's see. All right, so this is I'm hungry. Please give me one Czech crown. I'm going to buy myself one raspberry. It's very sad. There's also a version with like beer. Actually, I had a relative who kind of lived off of beer. Beer actually has a lot of calories. Yeah, it's either a raspberry or a beer. Yoi mamo, bokali malina, yoy mamo, yoy mamo, vocaliza. All right. How can you reach me? Yes, I have a website. It's www.musicbrains.net. Also, you can reach me through Families of Roma and Sinti Holocaust Victims, which is www.romaandsintiholocaust.org, I think. let me see. Let me type that to everybody. Roma Sinti, that's what it is, holocaust.org. You can tell I haven't been doing much on that. Or musicbrains.net, or even just my email. That's probably the easiest thing. Sorry, I'm like, I saw like website, so just trying to answer the question. But there you go. That's my email. Can you give examples of Romani surnames so that I might sometimes know when? You're not likely to know in America when you're crossing paths with someone of Romani heritage. You almost certainly have, and they almost certainly didn't tell you. There is, you know, even in America, there's so much stigma that the absolute overwhelming majority of Roma are not going to admit to you that they're Roma. It's only the, you know, weird activists like me who are like, yes, I'm Romani and I'm proud of it. And my whole family is like, oh, you're so nuts. You know, why are you doing this to yourself? Surnames, it's, you know, completely, it's not like Jewish surnames where you have like a giant subset of Jews that has certain kinds of surnames. It's not like that because we come from so many different countries. So it's not really going to help you. If you're in like the Czech Republic, then yeah, I could give you a bunch of names where more likely than not that person's going to be Romani, but those people aren't here, so it's not really helpful. I'm sorry. But if you'd like to meet some Roma, then keep in touch. We do have events, and you're welcome to come to the events, and you can interact with us all you want. Okay, I got a direct message, but I will share it. How can we help stop the stigma? Thank you. That is the best question. You know, obviously, you know, educate people, talk to your local, you know, schools. You can kind of, you know, a lot of stuff you can do on social media. Actually, being a clicktivist is super helpful with this. You know, there's like, just share our website, share the Rome Archive site with people, share, you know, our Holocaust sites. I have on my webpage, there are other links, you know, that you can share. You know, the reason that Holocaust education is so important to me isn't primarily because I feel a need to publicly commemorate our dead, even though that is really important, but we don't really need to involve the public in that. It's because for us, especially in America, it is the only realistic way that we will ever get to a point where my kids, I have three kids, and you know, they've sometimes had, you know, these unfortunate experiences even here. I mean, definitely back in Europe, there's been horrible stuff that's happened to them. But sometimes even here, unfortunate experiences in the schools where they're not, they're either, you know, kind of erased or they're misrepresented or they feel that they can't be honest about who they are because of the stigma or because people are just not going to get it, right? And I would love to, you know, for one day, for maybe my youngest to like get to his high school and just be able to say, yeah, we're Roma. And for people, for that to be like the same thing as like, I'm Cuban or I'm Puerto Rican or I'm French, right? And right now it's nothing like that. But if every kid who goes through middle school in their, you know, mandatory Holocaust education learns not just like a footnote or more often like nothing, they actually learn like who are the Romani people and they're this diverse group of people and they're like this and they're not like that and this is a stereotype and all this stuff, then it will have this really, really, you know, almost, I think, immediate impact on somebody like my kid and all the other, you know, Romani kids in New York City and everywhere else in the country where they can feel more included and more safe in their schools. So, yeah, so there's, but, you know, definitely feel free to be in touch. I also have, like, various social media, Roma Reality, if you're on Instagram. Is there, like, a underscore? I don't know. I don't know, see, I don't know my own Instagram. Yeah, so there's a lot of stuff you can do. Let's do another song. What are we going to do? Okay, well, so a lot of the ones kind of talking about, you know, like subsets of themes, there's definitely a lot of sad ones about moms dying or being sick. I could, like, show you ones, but I'll try to get through my live ones first. Because there's other stuff I want to show you. So this is a really beautiful one. It is about a mom dying, but... Mulas mange meridayori mulas mulas Muklas mange trinchavore muklas muklas Somechoro sokerava Chavlaronia Somechoro Sokerava Mustea Chavlaronia. Happy one. This one's going to be interactive. So this is a, okay. Or I'll answer a question. Yes, another great question. Can you say anything more about the spiritual / religious practices of the Roma? So this is where we really differ from Jews, although, you know, there are like Buddhist Jews, and obviously you can be born Jewish and like be any religion you want. I went to grad school with someone who converted to Islam. Who was like born Jewish and converted to Islam, you know, so like that's a thing. But we don't have like, you know, there's no such thing as like the Romani religion officially. But so what happened is we came out of South Asia and we definitely, and by we, I obviously mean my ancestors, carried a whole bunch of spiritual practices with them that were at base Hindu. You know, and some of them we have to this day, and by we, I mean various subgroups do different things, but like in my family, and this is not really me except for like not putting feet on the coffee table, but in my family, like when my mom was growing up, you have a whole bunch of ritual purity practices, and it's a lot like kashrut, like it includes things you can and can't eat. Things that can and can't touch, right? Ways that you have to ritually prepare food, or it's considered unclean, right? And also like people that you can and can't interact with in certain ways. So there's definitely a very similar concept of ritual purity, but it doesn't come out of a book. It's not like, oh, it's because this particular god, you know, said it. It's more like it's more like an animistic thing, like there are sort of forces that will be imbalanced, but nobody I personally know ever like talked about it that way. It's just like it's either clean or it's unclean, right? But basically, you know, one interesting thing is speaking of the vocative, so you know, we're talking about like if you call to a mother, it's a particular form of the word, because we have declensions in Romani. And the word for God, this has led to certain misunderstandings in English-speaking countries. The word for God is devil. Devil, which in those English-speaking countries is almost certainly pronounced more like devil. So, you know, there have been, like, apparently Romani children who were asked by their teacher, and how do you say God in your language? And they said devil, and the teacher completely freaked out. But the vocative of that is devla. So, oh God, is yai devla. That's, you have a lot of songs with yoi mamo, and also a lot of songs with yai devla, oh God, right? You're addressing God. But a certain minority songs, you have yoi devlale, which is oh gods, which is a really interesting thing because we are not in any known memory a polytheistic people. We are basically either Christian or Muslim. Like I said, there are some Roma who also like happen to be Jewish, but basically you're either Christian or Muslim if you're Romani. And it just depends most of the time on the dominant religion of where you happen to be. There's Roma in the Balkans who were Muslim and then they were forcibly converted to Christianity. I mean, there's things like that. But, you know, in the Balkans, you have both Islam and Christianity as dominant religions. But so these songs were suddenly, like, in the middle of the song, it's like, oh, gods. And it's kind of like, where did that come from? Like, us God, it's oh help us gods. So that's interesting. There's probably some scholar, a real scholar, who knows a lot more about this than I do, but I just know that we have like multiple gods in some of these songs. But in terms of, you know, spiritual practices, yeah, it's really varied. You have, you know, some people who are really into like my band Made by Yim, super into being Orthodox Christian, you know, that's his thing, he goes to church like every Sunday. You have various people who are Pentecostal is a huge thing now, the past like 20, 30 years, whatever. You can read Sieve's work. Some of the Manouche, so like the Romani people in France are actually called Manouche. It's like the Sinti, long story. So they actually, I years ago met some random Manouche people who were like proselytizing in the Czech Republic. So you see, you know, these random kind of interconnections, and they're really into being Pentecostal. I've got cousins who are Jehovah's Witnesses. I've got cousins who are really Catholic. I've got cousins who are kind of like, eh, you know, so it really just runs the gamut. And in terms of things that are specifically Romani, it's just a lot of syncretism. So, you know, so you have these things that you kind of like have to do. Certainly not everybody follows that. Different people follow different things in terms of the ritual purity. And I would say the majority of Roma these days don't follow much of anything. It's kind of like on its way out. But yeah, so I hope that answered that question. So the interactive thing, I do this with our foster families, but it's fun. It's a song about giving flowers to your mother because it's Mother's Day. So we're going to give a rose of different colors. And so where you come in is you tell me the color. So that's it. So who wants to pick the first color?
Red.
Red. That's generally how the song starts, so good guess. All right. Because, oh, mom, right? Mamo Miri. You've heard that before. I love her. I love you. Whatever. So that's it. All right, next color. We'll do, like, two more. Do you guys know your colors?
I'll give another color. Oh, here, Luis.
Peach or coral?
Peach or coral?
I don't know what word is going to be a word that you know the color in Romani.
I don't even know how to say that in Czech. I guess we'll just say koralovo. I don't know. It's sort of an international word. Koralovo ruja prečinova kaske melada. Okay, one more. I got purple, so that would be lilo. Lilo ruja prečinova kaske melada. Tava mela mirada ke pomela kama. Lilo ruja prečinova kaske melada. Tava mela mirada ke pomela kama. Tavo miri pomela kama. Lilo ruja la ke chinova. All right, so now let's just like randomly pick some of the stuff I didn't get to. One really cool thing I didn't get to with Roma and Jews working together is the Romani theater in Moscow. It's called the Theater Romen. It was founded in 1931, and it's both like really cheesy and schmaltzy by today's standards, but also really important for so many things. Culturally, that kind of style of singing and dancing really spread to Ukraine and Slovakia and various other people. Between Two Fires is a book about that. Yes. Yes. And it's actually, speaking of, it's still it's not written by a Romani person. She's an anthropologist named Elena Lemon, and it's still hands down one of my favorite things that anybody's ever written about Roma. So if you're at all interested in like understanding Romani and non-Romani relations and also have any interest in Russia, just read that book. It's really great.
You put it in the chat again so we get
Steve is
so
gonna
get
put
the title.
It in the chat because she's awesome and she's my assistant today. Thank you. See, what a great ally. But this theater was founded by Roma and Jews, so that's the thing. In communist the Soviet Union, and there's a lot of stuff I'm not going to say about it, but it was not just making theater and making music and dance, but it was associated with a lot of some of the first literature that Roma produced, because historically we were not a people who had literature. So that's really cool, and absolutely, to the extent to which that entire enterprise was made possible in part by the Jewish leaders that were part of it, we are very grateful. And so I just want to show you one kind of random, tried to find a good one, and spent a half hour looking. But anyway, a random example of a performance from this theater. Oh no, I just closed the whole thing. I should not have done that. Let me see if I can get the tabs back. Oh, I can. Maybe. Let's see. I'm going to close all the Yiddish mamas. What? Okay. Sorry. No. Here we go. Okay. Let me now click share. Play. To somewhere. right. So much fun. There's more where that came from. You've got the links, and also just look up like Russian. They even have a website, you know, the Russian Gypsy Theater. So there's that.
Petra, I'm just warning you about time. We have three more minutes.
We're out of time. Okay, so maybe like one more song and then maybe a couple questions. Although you guys have been really great about asking them all along, which is wonderful. Okay, I'll do one more kind of pop song about asking mom for advice. All right. There's also, I mean, there's a ton of songs about like children too. You know, so various. Thank you, Petra. Thank you, Dr. Gelbart.